Today I'm preaching a little bit different than the way I normally preach. Today I'm preaching a narrative sermon. Let me tell you what a narrative message is. I am telling you a story. My message is wrapped around a story. I'm going to tell you a story. I'm not giving you no points. It's not going to be point one, point two, point three. You ain't going to see no points on the screen. What you need to do is write whatever the Holy Ghost tells you while we're preaching. Amen. That rousing support, I appreciate that so much. The last 4 weeks, I've been preaching on destiny. Last week we talked about that God causes all things to work together for our good. For those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. The week, 3 weeks before that, we preached from Luke 22, again dealing with destiny. And today I feel compelled of God to talk to people who are in danger of aborting their destiny. It is important that you know that you can make some decisions and choices that will cause you to miss out on what God has for your life. And I know that's true because there are some places in the Bible where that has happened. One of those situations is the story of Samson, and that's what I'm going to talk about is Samson. If you have your Bibles, you can turn to Judges chapter 14. I'm going to look at a couple of verses, but if you get an opportunity to read verses 13 through 16, those chapters, 13, 14, 15, and 16, tell the story of Samson's life. And what happened with Samson is this. Samson is a guy whose very birth is the supernatural provisions of God. Here's a guy whose parents could not get pregnant. His mother couldn't get pregnant. And so she prayed to God that if God gave her a child, gave her a male son, she would dedicate that child to God. And that's what she did. She prayed and God gave her a male son. His name was Samson. She was so devoted to committing that child to God that she committed him to be a Nazarite. And what a Nazarite is an Israeli who dedicates their lives to the purposes of God. And he embraced it too. He accepted that as a call and an assignment on his life, that he was going to be a Nazarite. Now, in order to be a Nazarite, you had to make three commitments. Somebody say three. Here's the first one. The first commitment was you couldn't drink. No drinking. Look at your neighbor and say, that counts you out right off the bat for being a Nazarite. You are disqualified. Secondly, being a Nazarite meant that you would not cut your hair. He had dreads before dreads were in style. We know from the story that Samson's strength was in the locks of his hair. He gained his strength by virtue of the fact that he never cut his hair and God gave him supernatural strength. I think it's interesting, just as a side note, to talk about for just a moment the fact that the Bible gives us a lot of insight about hair. There's a lot of places that the Bible talks about hair, all over the Bible, lots of scriptures. And I believe that when you read about hair in the Bible, it is a symbol of character. It represents character. Somebody say character. So here's what I take about hair from, this is just a side note. This ain't the gist of the message, just a side note. I take from the fact that his strength was in the locks of his hair, I take as a point of application and truth that if hair represents character, then in fact, our strength as believers is not in what we do, but in who we are. And ultimately, that's what your strength is. It's not in the kind of job you have or the kind of clothes that you wear or the kind of house you live in. Our strength is that we have the character of Jesus being reflected inside of us. I take that from Samson's story. I take from the fact that the Bible says that John the Baptist wore camel's hair. He dressed differently from everybody else. he uniquely dressed by wearing camel's hair. I take that to say to us that God wants us to act differently than the rest of the world acts. Our character is to not be conformed to what the rest of the world's doing. When Paul wrote in Corinthians that a woman should keep her hair long and a man should keep his hair short, that he's not talking about the physical aspects of hair, but he is speaking about character. And by him saying that women's hair should be long and a man's hair short, he's trying to draw a distinction between the characters. In other words, God is saying that a man's character should be different than a woman's character. So you ought to be able to look at a man and tell he's a man. You ought to be able to look at a woman and tell she's a woman by the way they act. You come to my house, I am the man. If a couch needs to be moved, I move the couch. With the finances, I manage the money. I don't in my household, I don't go to my wife to get money. So I need some money for the electric bill. I don't go to my wife. That's my responsibility to take care of it. Not a brother clapped his hand. Not a single brother clapped his hand. Anyway, that's a side note. Let me leave that alone. I done lost some people just on that point right there. Samson's strength was in the locks of his hair. And so being a Nazarite meant that he wouldn't cut his hair. So he didn't drink. He didn't cut his hair. Thirdly, being a Nazarite meant that he would not come near or touch anything dead, any dead bodies. It's a commitment that he made. So these were the commitments that Nazarenes made. He made a commitment. And that's the commitment that he made. And so, and not only did his mother, make this commitment to God that she would dedicate him to the purposes of God, he also committed that he would do that. Now, here's the deal. I'm not going to keep y'all long. I promise I'll get you out of here by 2:30, 3 o'clock at the latest. Samson is a guy who had an assignment and a destiny in his life. He had great purpose. As a matter of fact, if you just read through chapters 13 through 16, you'll read about some of the great exploits that he had occur in his life. For 20 years, he served as a judge in Israel. For 20 years. Here's a guy who God gave him the power and the ability. He caught 300 foxes, tied them together, put torches to their tails, and sent those 300 foxes through the field of the enemy and burned up the enemy's fields. He did great exploits. Here's a guy who took the jawbone of a donkey and killed 1,000 men by himself. This guy had great exploits. When his enemies tried to tie him down and rope him and contain him, he was so strong that he was able to break the ropes that they had to tie him down. Here's a guy who with his bare hands killed a lion. He had great exploits, but the problem is, as I'm telling you right here, that here's a guy who had a great purpose and a great assignment and a great destiny, but because he could not get his flesh under control, he ended up aborting his destiny. And I'm afraid we got some descendants of Samson here today. We got some people that are about to compromise their destiny because they cannot get their flesh under control. They cannot get their life under control. Here's a guy who ended up missing out on everything that God had for him. In spite of all of the provisions that God made for him, he ended up missing out and ended up compromising and ended up losing his life prematurely. As a matter of fact, y'all know he ended up in the lap of Delilah. There he is, laid up in another woman's lap that's not his wife. I don't have to go far today to find testimonies of people who ended up in somebody else's lap that wasn't their wife. And it cost them their lives, cost them their careers, cost them their jobs. And they answered him not a word. Y'all do know that what I'm telling you is truth. You do know that, right? I know why y'all quiet, because y'all thinking about the Delilahs that you have in your own life. Because everybody in here got a Delilah. Come on. You either got a Delilah or a David. Come on, son. Maybe your Delilah's name is David or Devin. Hey, Devin is your man. That's his name. You got somebody, something in your life. And here he pours out his heart to this woman, and she ends up taking the information and ends up cutting his hair. He loses his strength, and it eventually cost him his life. A lot of people ended up compromising and sacrificing their lives for a momentary thrill. Now, here's the deal. He didn't get into the situation of being in Delilah's lap overnight. He didn't just wake up one day and he was in Delilah's lap. He didn't wake up one morning and there he was entangled in a relationship with Delilah. It didn't happen overnight. It happened because over the course of time, he had small compromises. That's what messes you up, small compromise. And I'm not giving y'all no subject. I'm going to give you the subject at the end. I need to tell you that, because y'all act like y'all waiting on me to tell y'all something. I'm going to give you the subject at the end. Tell your neighbor, he going to give you the subject at the end. Don't wait on the subject. He going to give it to you at the end. It's a narrative sermon. Don't wait on points. Write down whatever God tells you. He ain't going to give you no points. Tell him. Tell your neighbor what I said. Small compromises. We see in chapter 16, he saw a prostitute and went and slept with her. He had an affinity for women. 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 And it got him in trouble. Somebody say amen. Got him in trouble. He didn't get there overnight. It's small compromises. And the first compromise that opened the door is right here in chapter 14. Now, can you walk with me through this one incident that sets the stage for the rest of his life that causes his downfall? In chapter 14 of Judges, are y'all there? Did I say turn to Judges 14? In verse 5, now let me give you some background. And earlier in chapter 14, he saw a woman that he was attracted to that he wanted to be his wife. He finally found a woman to be his wife. And he's in good shape here. He finds a woman he wants to be his wife, and he tells his parents about it, and he wants to take his parents down to meet her. And in verse 5, so Samson went down to Timnah with his father and mother and came to the vineyards of Timnah. Now to his surprise, a young lion came roaring against him. Stop right there. He's on his way to get his wife with his parents, going to hook up, and he gets attacked by a young roaring lion. Anytime you have a destiny, anytime you're going somewhere, anytime you have a purpose, somewhere on that journey, a lion is going to come up against you. Something is going to come roaring to try to destroy you. Something is going to come against you to try to take you out. Something is going to come and try to defeat you. And in Samson's case, it was a young roaring lion. And here's the deal, brothers. Some of y'all are going to get jacked up because there's going to be a young roaring lion. Something that a young thing is going to come up against you. It wasn't no old toothless lion coming up against you. Y'all come on and tell the truth that you got some lions. You got some stuff that comes up in your life. And here's the deal. The young roaring lion is something in your own strength and abilities you would never be able to conquer. By your own strengths and abilities. In the human sense, he could never defeat a young roaring lion by himself. But here's the key. The key is that verse number 6 says, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him, and he tore the lion apart as one would have torn apart a young goat, though he had nothing in his hand. He killed the lion with his bare hands by himself with no assistance. Why? Because the Spirit of God came upon him and gave him the power to do supernaturally what he could not do in his own strength and power. And you need to know that whatever that lion is, whatever that thing is that's coming up against you, whatever that thing is that's coming to take you out, whatever that lion is that's trying to kill you, God will give you the strength and the power to overcome and take it and give you the victory. I wish I had an amen crowd somewhere in here. God will give you supernatural ability to overcome and defeat the young lions in your life. Not only did it happen in this case, but in several occasions in Samson's life, the Spirit of God came upon him and gave him power to overcome. Now, the difference between Samson's day and our day is in Samson's day, the Holy Spirit came upon men for a special assigned task, for a special assigned time, and when that task was done, the Spirit of God would leave and return back to God. But we have the blessings of having the Holy Ghost living and dwelling inside of us day in day out. He does not depart. He stays with us. Hallelujah. Somebody give God a shout right there. So no matter what comes up beckoning you, calling you, the young lions come and they gonna come. He got the victory. So he killed the young lion. And there, here it is. And y'all got lions. Come on. Y'all got stuff that you don't have the strength to walk away from. But God gives you the supernatural ability by his grace and by the Holy Ghost to not only conquer it, but to kill it. There's some things that God will kill in your life. There's some relationships he will kill, some habits he will kill, some stuff that would take you out. He will kill it. I don't know who you are. If you're a drug addict, a prostitute, a whoremonger, a homosexual, a lesbian, an alcoholic, a womanizer, a manizer, I don't care what you are, whatever your issue is, the Holy Ghost will give you the power to kill it in your life. Hallelujah. I wish I had a praying crowd. I wish I had somebody to pray with me. He'll kill it in your life. He'll kill it in your life. He killed it. There's some relationships that were about to take you out, but God killed it. Some people you got hooked up with that didn't mean you good, but God will help you kill it. Hallelujah. He'll end the relationship. He'll give you the victory. He'll give you the ability to conquer it. And that's what happened with Samson. He killed it. He killed the lion. That thing that was designed to kill him, he killed it. Amen. Verse 7 says, Then he went down and talked with the woman, and she pleased Samson well. And after some time, when he returned to get her, to get his wife, he turned aside to see the carcass of the lion. Now capture this. He's going back to get his wife, and on his return journey to get her, he sees the carcass of the lion that he had killed. He saw the remains of the lion laying there, and he saw it. And the text says, and behold, verse 8, a swarm of bees and honey were in the carcass of the lion. Now here's the problem. He goes over to take a look at this carcass of a lion. And he notices that there's some honey in the lion. You get in trouble when you go to check out something that God done killed in your life. Y'all miss that point. You in trouble when you just call them to see how they doing. When you just going by the club just to see who might be there that used to be there. I can't get no help up in here. Up in here. he went over, and to know that there was a swarm of bees with honey in it, he had to go down and look inside it. And that's what gets you in trouble, checking on it, seeing how you're doing, driving by to see whose car is there. Y'all can't get no help up in here. Was checking it out, and it got him in trouble because he saw something in it that was that he liked. He liked honey. And how many of you know your carcass got just what you like? It got just the thing that turns you on. Hey! Look at your neighbor and say, that carcass is going to cost you your destiny. It's dead. It's over. It's ended. But you still dabbling with it. You still messing with it. You still calling it. You still emailing it. You still text messaging it. And it's gonna cost you your destiny. He liked the smell of it. He liked the looks of it. And here's the problem. He had had honey before, and his memory reminded him how good honey tasted. But somewhere down along the journey, God's got to make the taste of his love be better than you than the taste of the honey. Teaching up in hell, y'all can't handle the truth. You got to have a love for God that supersedes anything that you've ever had in the world. You got to have an encounter with God that will smother out what the world has to offer. The Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Can I get some help up in here? High five your neighbor and say, he's good all the time. Find him on the other side and say he's good all the time. Hallelujah. Hey! Now here's the problem. The problem is he was a Nazarite. And a Nazarite is not supposed to be touching anything that's dead. What gets you in trouble is you messing with stuff that you know as a Christian you ain't got no business messing with. You know you ain't got no business doing that. You know you ain't got no business going there. You know you ain't got no business messing with somebody else's husband, messing with somebody else's wife. You know you ain't got no business on the internet watching pornography. You know you ain't got no business messing with no drugs. You know you ain't supposed to be there, but you still messing with it. And it's gonna cost you your destiny. Look at your neighbor, say it's gonna cost you your destiny. Tell him. Tell them on the other side, it's going to cost you your destiny. Tell them behind you. Tap on the shoulders in front of you. Tell them it's going to cost you ask him, is it worth it? Is it worth missing out on everything that God? Is a little momentary thrill worth missing out on God? Is a little orgasm worth missing out on God? Is a little high worth missing out on God? Is a little... Why y'all looking at me like that? I got to go street with this crowd. I got to go street with y'all. Because this crowd can't handle me talking with y'all nicely. I got to go street with y'all. I got to go to the hood with y'all. I know it looks good. I know it smells good. I know it tastes good. Here is my subject today. Leave the honey alone. High five somebody, say, leave the honey alone. Tell them again, leave the honey alone. It's not worth it. It's not worth your destiny. It's not worth your life. It's not worth it. It's not worth it. Leave the honey alone. Don't touch it. Don't feel it. Don't rub it. Don't smell it. Don't sniff it. Don't squeeze it. Don't snort it. Don't shoot it. Don't look at it. Don't listen to it. Don't lay on it. Don't holler at it. Don't hump on it. Don't hang out with it. Don't taste it. Don't lick it. Don't borrow it. Don't kiss it. Don't blow on it. Don't try it. Don't test it. Don't call it. Don't date it. Don't marry it. Don't buy something for it. Don't write it. Don't email it. Don't text message it. Don't page it. Don't instant message it. Don't cry over it. Don't bemoan it. Don't visit it. Don't check on it. Don't drive by it. Don't two-way it. Don't bleep it. Don't tweet it. Don't Facebook it. Don't MySpace it. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Leave the honey alone. Hey! Leave it alone. You got too much at risk. Leave it alone. You got a future in front of you. Leave it alone. You have a call on your life. Leave it alone. You have a God that loves you. Leave the honey alone. It will kill you. It will destroy you. It will take you out. And that little bitty good feeling, that little momentary pleasure, is not worth missing out on everything that God has for your life. Who am I preaching to today? Come here. Come here. Come here. I'm gonna pray for you. Come here. Come here. You know, you got some stuff you got some lions and some Delilahs that God done killed that you messing with. Come on. You trying to get with him. Leave it alone. Come up close as you can. We got a whole lot of honey liquors that we need to get as close to the altar as we can get. Really? Is it worth it? Is it really worth it? That little feeling for a minute. Is it worth missing out on what God has for you? Y'all not saying nothing. I asked y'all a question. Y'all thinking about it. They answered him not a word. It's not worth it. But we sometimes allow our emotions and our flesh to rule past what we should be operating on in our life based on convictions. Leave it alone. Some of y'all need to leave here today. Some of y'all need to change your phone numbers. Some of y'all need to change your email addresses. Vote for Stephen first, then change your email address. There's some trips you would take going past places that you have no business driving by. You need to discover a new route that you don't have to go that way. You need to tell yourself, I don't need this in my life. Say it, I don't need it. Tell your neighbor, look and say, you don't need it. Tell him, just keep telling him, you don't need it. You do not need it. Jesus is all you need. That's who you need, is Jesus. I appreciate y'all's honesty. Because, you know, some people are so churchy that they don't want to be honest. But we're trying very much to cultivate a church where people can be honest about what they got going on in their life. But I don't want to be a part of a church where people are pretending like everything's okay. But I appreciate y'all getting up out of your seat and being honest with yourself and with God. Say, God, I got something beckoning me. You need to learn how to just walk on by. Walk on by. Did I say that in this service already? I didn't say that, did I? That's the last service. Some stuff you need to just walk on by. Samson should have just walked on by that carcass. But instead, he went over to check on it. How many people's lives got jacked up? Because they went to check on something that God had killed in their life. It's a new day today, baby. It's a new day for you now. Those days of that which used to take you out, it has no control over you any longer. It cannot hold you any longer. You're free. You're free. You're free. You're free. Hallelujah. You're free. Now, what I want you to do is, you know what your thing is. You know what your lion or lions are. I just want you to go ahead and talk to God. Say, God, you know what? Forgive me that I'm even entertaining letting this thing back up in my life. Forgive me that I'm even looking in that direction. Forgive me for even going by, checking on it, taking the call. I shouldn't even answer the phone. Forgive me. Ask God to forgive you. Go ahead. Confess it to him. Tell God, I'm sorry. Tell God, I know there's some stuff beckoning and calling me, and I keep feel like going back, but I'm not going back. I'm making a decision right here at this altar today. I'm not going back. Tell God, in fact, I'm giving myself to you, Lord. I'm giving myself to you. I'm not giving myself to another thing, to another person, to another addiction, to another habit. I give myself to you. Go ahead, pray, y'all. Open your mouth and talk to God. I give myself to you. Have mercy, Father. God, in the name of Jesus, bring transformation into the lives of your people. Let your truth prevail, that you love them, that you have a purpose and an assignment. let them walk away by the power of your Holy Spirit to leave the lion alone. Leave the honey alone. Hallelujah. Let the power of your Spirit rule and reign. In the name of Jesus. Have your way, God. Hallelujah. Oh, God, I feel freedom breaking out in this camp. I feel people getting released. I feel people getting freedom up in here today. Hey! Hallelujah! 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 Yeah, you're getting free today. You're getting free. You're getting free. You're getting free right now. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! 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 Bless his name. Bless his name. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Yes. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lift your hands and praise him. Y'all lift your hands. Father, thank you. Thank you for the victory. Thank you for the victory. Thank you for the breakthrough. Thank you for the word. Thank you for the challenge. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I decree the blood and the name of Jesus over you right now. No weapon, no plot, no scheme of the enemy shall succeed against you. In Jesus' name, I decree today that the enemy has no say, no authority, no power. You belong to Jesus. You are his son. You are his daughter. You belong to him. In Jesus' name, Jesus' name. Go ahead and give God some praise. Give him some praise.
Breakthrough in this worship. There's an answer for your situation in this worship. Give it to the Lord. Every situation, every concern, every problem, in the name of the Lord.
Give myself.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, to Jesus. To Jesus. Surrender it to Jesus. You've come. Myself away. But you're saying to the Lord, you have permission, God. Whatever you want to do in this situation, this thing, you give it to him. Come on, you've come too far to turn around now. You've come, there's a breakthrough in this place. Come on, give it to Jesus. Tell him, I give myself to you. I give my heart to you. I give my life to you. I give this thing to you. Come on, surrender it to the Lord. So about you.
Listen, here's what brings transformation. Repentance and faith. Those are the two things right there. Transformation is brought by repentance and faith. So you made the commitment, I'm turning away. Come on, turn around, say, I'm turning away, I'm turning away. There you go. What you're doing right now physically is what you're making the decision in your soul. I'm turning away, and I'm turning to God. Say, I'm turning to God. I'm turning to Jesus. I'm turning to Jesus. I'm putting my faith in God. You got to trust him that he has a purpose. He has a plan. He has a destiny for your life, and you are going to reach that destiny. Somebody give God a shout. I'm going somewhere. Say that again. I give myself. Listen carefully. Don't nobody move till you hear me give my instructions. Some of you at this altar need to rededicate yourself to God. You know, you've drifted away. You might. How many know you can go to church every week and be far from God? How many of y'all know that? Amen. Those of you who need to rededicate yourself afresh to God, I want you to stay at this altar. Those of you who have never accepted Jesus, you need to be saved. I want you to stay at this altar. Those who are saved but you need a church home, and you want to join this great church. Hey, ain't this a great church, y'all? It's a great church. I want you to stay. You're already saved. You need a church. You want to join our church. Stay. unsaved, backslidden, you're not sure, you want to be sure of where you're going to spend eternity, or you want to join our church, stay. If you're not at the altar and you fall in one of those categories, make your way down here. The rest of you, I want you to hug somebody and say, I'm leaving the honey alone. Go ahead, go on back to your seat. Proud of you. Ain't nobody mad but the devil. The devil mad today, y'all.